From making sure that the lights are just right to finding out why they make the streets wet when they shoot film at night, Sacramento Film Works is your one-stop shop for all things filmmaking. I'm your host, Klein Moore.
And I'm your co-host, Amy Henry. We're so glad to be with you today. Sit tight. We're going to be right back. We're talking about the show on the show today, the making of film behind the scenes. Stay tuned.
So you just finished watching your favorite DVD, and now up pops a special feature section, and it says behind the scenes. Now, what does that really mean? Tonight, we're going to find out.
We are going to find out, and we're excited to welcome Tom Merino. Tom, welcome to the show.
Pleasure to be here.
Thanks for being here. We want to find out what it takes to handle, to create behind the scenes of a film. So you're going to share that with us and talk to us a little bit about your background
Sure.
in filmmaking.
Well, we can start from the beginning. Background in filmmaking. There's a lot of filmmakers here tonight, right? Yay, filmmakers.
Right.
And we come from a lot of different places. You were maybe working in retail, or you're a teacher, or whatever, or you're just a student and you want to make your movie. You have to start from some place, and you have a history. You bring things to what you're doing. As a filmmaker, that doesn't change. You come to filmmaking, and you're good at detail, or you're good at hands-on work, and so you're going to be better with camera or handling things. So with the experience I had, just jumping right in from film school, you know, film school is good no matter what they tell you. It's the jumping off point. You have to know when you've had enough and there's opportunities out there. I started working in film because my teacher gave me a name to some producers he knew. He says, you know, they need some help, but there's no pay. Mm-hmm. I said, I'm there. Mm-hmm. No pay. Wow.
Mm-hmm. We got to pay dues one way or another.
I paid, right. And it was a Reebok commercial. I'll never forget. It was Maureen Jahan, the lady who did the flash dance dancing for... She was a stunt dancer.
Right.
She's great. And she was doing Reebok stuff, and it was great. And then from there... condense this short story for you for history and all this junk people talk about and just on about their history. I'm just telling you, I work for free because I wanted to get in. And then you do a good job and they say, we want you again. And I said, yeah, but you got to pay me this time. And they will if you do a good job. And so from there, I started learning as like Scorsese talks about the filmmaker as many parts, thief, priest, magician. You have to be all these things. So as a thief, I took the walkie-talkies off the camera truck, and there was a spare. I didn't steal it, but I wore it. And I could hear everything that's going on. I asked the ADs, okay, just so I could help out, guys? You know, yeah, go ahead. So, where's the makeup gal? I got it right here. I'm on her. Tom. Oh, thanks, Tom. So who's Tom? Tom's on the radio.
He's a go-to
I'm everywhere.
Guy, right.
I'm everywhere. And I just did that. And pretty soon I got stepped up to a set PA. You're the PA, production assistant, who gets to be on the set. You're not closing off a door, and you're not down the street watching, the dog, who's the stunt dog in the things that does get loose. You know, you got to be in the middle of things. And it took a while, but, you know, you work your way up to craft service. Ooh, there's a great job. The point being, I was watching everything. And when I was an AD, I think that's one of the worst jobs and the best jobs, okay? You get to meet everyone. You're the go-to guy, but you're also the one that everything turns around. You go to the AD for everything. Did everyone get the call sheets? Is makeup ready? The wardrobe had a clash. You guys are supposed to coordinate this. Now I got makeup and no wardrobe. You know, things that happen.
Yeah.
There's a truck that's not supposed to be there. We got to eat lunch there. That's my problem, not the director's problem, not the producer's problem. I got to figure all this stuff out. So you're the first guy there, last one to leave as a second AD. First AD, it's a little easier. And then from knowing how the set worked, the language of the set, not tripping over on things, how to actually organize these people.
And work with all the different personalities.
Them, yes. Right. Oh, that was cool, too, because you get to work with all the actors who are crazy, wonderful people. I love actors. And because I had this insight access to these people, when the opportunity came for me to do behind the scenes, it was the producer. One of my buddies was producing for Anchor Bay. They make the DVDs. Well, you got to put, how did you make the movie, right? When you click on that, well, someone's got to shoot all that. So he's a separate producer who would send a guy, me, out there to shoot stuff. Okay. And then just turn it in, and it has to be something they like. So as a filmmaker, now I'm closing all this in. As the thief, magician, filmmaker guy, knowing what a story is like, because I write too, I could bring all that. There was three guys shooting, hired this guy for that film, this guy for that film, and Tom. Now those guys went away because they wanted me all the time. Huh. I knew what to shoot. When they got my stuff, they could put together a great behind the scenes because they weren't wasting footage.
And you basically took all of the knowledge that you had gathered from doing all these different things.
Right.
Because basically you're on your own when you're shooting behind the scenes.
Yep, there are no bosses.
No one's telling you, get this shot, right. Do this in particular.
And the producers, I should correct you just in a sec because I didn't give you enough information. The producer will be with you because it's his baby, right?
Sure.
He's paying things. And he'll show up and go, man, we got to get this today, and he'll write stuff out. And then pretty soon it's like he'll just show up and he's having coffee, craft service, and he leaves because he knew I was doing it. You know, how's it today, Tom? It's great. You got good stuff today. And that was nice. It was freedom. It was freedom to go forward on the set, kind of my own captain of my own ship.
So they give you some direction, but for the most part, you got to get a ton of footage and then drop it off and hope that you got something good. Well, how do you decide what to shoot and what not to?
They give you some help. They don't show up and hold your hand, but they say, the volcano's blowing up today. Great. That's all I need.
Okay.
I'm going to get there earlier because it's going to be a lot of pyrotechnics. Oh, they're doing the fly work where the two guys, vampires, are fighting in the air.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So that's a lot of, I want to be there for that. So I get early, talk to the riggers, see what they're doing, rigging the lines. So it's just a heads up. Like, I got my own call sheet. You guys know what a call sheet is, right? You know, it tells you what's being shot today, who's in it, what happens. Yeah. Well, I had my little call sheet. It was just kind of a list of shots. Sometimes it was oral over the phone, just shoot this and this and this today. If it was a lot of talking, I wouldn't shoot that because it's kind of boring for behind the scenes. What are you going to watch? Dialogue. There is some dialogue, but they don't send me out on that stuff. I was going out for the action. A lot of technical stuff, a lot of action, a lot of like, we got to get it now because we can't afford to do it again. So you got to have a camera guy who's going to go in there and not be in the way, know where to be, and kind of like, that's why they called me back, because I wasn't in the way.
Oh,
and
okay.
That's how you stay within budget, because they give you a budget too. They're not going to bring you on for the whole range of the movie.
Right. Yeah, I was there for the day, so it's either if I'm there for an hour or 12 hours, that was their budget. The budget you had to be concerned with is, how much did I shoot today? Well, I shot like 8 hours of tape out of a 12-hour day. I was shooting every second when I first started. You know, I go, we don't need that much. You're shooting everything. And I was like so exhausted. But then when you get into the
The groove of learning
exactly
what they want.
Okay. And the synchronization of it. And so for your audience, I want to help you guys remember that you guys are all filmmakers in one form or another. You're how many writers do we have here? A few. There's the technical people are here. You like editing and you like camera. You know, I love photography and I hate cameras. But, that's my love-hate relationship. I'm not Mr. Technical, but we do what we have to do to get the job done.
Now, a lot of your shots are already set up because they're shooting the movie with the main camera.
That's so cool.
So you just have to shoot a little back.
Hey, I got to shoot stuff that you guys would dream about, because who's got the money to do this great, it's all lit and there's explosions and fire and a guy falls through the thing. It was great. But it better be good, because I have no excuse.
Well, in a minute, we're going to go to a clip. But right before we do, and we see some of your behind-the-scenes work, I just want to ask, how do you get that close shot without being in the way?
Yeah.
I mean, or throwing an actor off, or, how is another camera in the mix,
right,
not obtrusive, but yet close enough to
good
the
question.
Action?
No, that's a good question. The answers are layered. You can say, well, if you've never been on a set before, it's going to be bad. You don't know where to stand.
Mm-hmm.
So you got to have some experience. Know where not to be, because you understand the flow. If they're laying out track, well, the camera's going to move.
Mm-hmm.
So you know not to be here, because it's going to go from there to here. Things like that. So you have to know the language of film. You have to understand how that inner city, that little world works. That comes from just being on the set. Anyone should be able to get on the set. Read the trades. Call the production office. I used to call the production office at lunchtime because the girl, the receptionist or guy, wouldn't be there. They're usually on lunch because they take a scheduled lunch. the coordinator or the production managers don't take scheduled anything. Mm-hmm. They usually come in around 10, you know, because they work late. And I'd go and I'd say, hey, I want to leave my resume. And there's some guy in a room. Oh, I'm the coordinator. I'll just leave it here. Where are you? And I got to talk to him. So that was one of my ways of getting in. Every, what was it, Tuesdays? Maybe, I don't know, on the Hollywood Reporter, there was a certain day it had all the productions listed and their addresses sometimes. Drive there. Don't mail it. Drive there, lay it down, find someone. And I'd say, yeah, my PA, I'll, you know, do whatever. Well, we need one, okay, boom, you get in.
Wow. Well, you got your way in, you're doing great work. Let's go to that clip, and we're gonna check out some of the behind the scenes as shot by Tom Marino. And so a lot of these actors are acting for you sometimes. So they may have done a whole day of shooting for the film, but you're getting them on the off moments or after a shot and saying, mm-hmm. how'd that feel, or getting them to do something funny. How do you do that?
Well, it's kind of like, it's kind of easy if you look at it this way. You're there for them. You're there and they know it. They know I'm going to be on the DVD, and they, you know, you're helping them have fun and
be good. FaceTime.
More FaceTime, yeah, and you get to, they want the DVD to be good. And so I think we showed a clip of the young lady eating a leg.
Right. Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. That was a real leg, by the way.
So,
oh.
And you suggested, though, why don't you say this line, you'll make it on the DVD trailer.
Sure, because the extras who are, you know, they are working so hard. She did have a line or two in the film, but mostly it was just screaming and stuff. And I said, you know, whatever, I forgot her name, it's a long time ago, I only saw her for like 20 minutes, but let's call her Jane. If you want to be on the DVD, she says, yeah, well, you got to do something. Let's make a little shtick. Pick up a leg and start chewing on it and say, like, I sure am tired of eating humans. Okay, can you do that? She made it to the DVD, so she got some FaceTime.
Wow.
So, I mean, just thinking of those things on the spot, just directing, helped me kick, you know, those other guys out. They were coming. Those are great guys. I know those other photographers.
And you've learned all this just over the years, and that truly came through with what you just shared with our viewers. Thank you so much, Tom.
And when we come back, we're going to go to our audience, and we're going to give them some FaceTime with Tom Marino.
Yay.
Sacramento Film Works is sponsored by the Northern California Filmmakers Coalition, which provides filmmakers an opportunity to learn and network with professionals in the filmmaking industry in the Sacramento region. Join us each Wednesday at 6 p.m. at Access Sacramento, 4623 T Street, Suite A. We'll see you in the movies. Welcome back to Sacramento Film Works, and we're going to Amy in our studio audience.
Well, we are excited to bring a few questions for Tom, so I'd like to introduce our first question. Tell us your name.
My name is Mamie Jean Calvert, and I would like to ask Tom, how creative can you be behind the scenes with your shots?
You can be creative in a couple of ways. That's a good question. One of the things I did was to grab it. Well, I didn't grab it, but I saw a tarantula. Okay, call it creative in a different way because I saw an opportunity. And one of the actresses was happened to be close by, the lead actress. And I got a stuntman who will do anything. He'll probably eat a tarantula. I know this guy, Charlie, he's great. And I said, Charlie, look at this. There's a tarantula here. Maybe we can get the actress to look at it. She'll freak out and it'll be great. And it was great. He actually got her to put the tarantula in her hand. But that's from just, you know, you call it, well, it's not that creative. It's just being a producer, director, you just see the moment, you make it happen. It's mostly like that. Creative-wise, and the shots, I mean, you did some low-angle stuff. I'd run around with a camera to do some transitions for the editor. Sometimes he'd keep it, sometimes he wouldn't. But You have an opportunity to be creative in several ways, yes. Yeah, this is one of them.
Great, thank you. Good question. All right, our next question, your first name?
It's Anne.
And your question for Tom.
Oh, is it really difficult to get the actors, especially the really famous ones, like Christine Taylor in the clip you had there, is it hard to get them to do things for you in the background stuff?
I've been fortunate. It's been fairly easy. It depends on how you approach them. And don't forget, you don't just meet them for the first day, never said a word to them, and then you say, hey, let's do this. You have lunch with them. You kind of see how they are with other people. And you kind of know who you can talk to and who you should really give space to. But most of the time, they're happy to fool around because, as a lot of you know, working on the set it's tedious. It can be boring sometimes. And breaking it up with a clown like on the set like me doing some weird stuff, they kind of like the idea.
But then we talked before the show, and you said that some of these are consummate professionals. They know it's a part of the job, and they love their craft. So even some of the more famous ones, they're willing to take some time out and have a joke or do something funny or show the audience another side of them other than just a character.
You know, people are people, Klein, and there's some people that are a little uptight, and some people are just Ray Park, who was Darth Maul. What an acrobat, because there's martial arts and stuff. I'm talking to the director, right? And I got a shot with the director. He was nice enough. Everyone's tired, but Kevin is going to give me a few minutes. In the background is Ray Park doing handstands and juggling skulls. And I'm going, this is great. But he knew this is going to be really cool. And Kevin liked it too, because he was being, kind of made to look foolish, but he thought it was great. Anyway, it was a blast. So some people are like that. Yeah.
Good. Thanks, Tom. And your question, what is your first name?
My name is Samoria, and I have a question for Tom. Tom, do you know when bloopers first started in the movies?
I think the first, in the movies. Yeah. Well, the first blooper was probably maybe Al Jolson in The Jazz Singer, 1927, the first talking sound film. I have no idea, because I think there had to be a blooper, where he says something, but we didn't see this stuff. Like Klein and I were talking. Bloopers have always been around, but we haven't released them. That's all it is. That footage is on the floor or in the outtakes, all these outtakes. And there's Shirley Temple, I saw in some outtakes, saying, I need water now, or asking for something. And it was like someone responded to her in a funny way. So that's not going to make it on the news, but maybe now it will, because we have changed as an audience. That would be like, oh, it's so disrespectful, maybe back then. How could they show that? But we've changed. So blooper reels have been around forever. We just haven't seen them.
And fans want to see them now. Yeah. So there's a market for that. And you were talking earlier about that there's now companies that's all they do. They specialize in doing behind the scenes. They'll come in and say, we'll shoot your behind the scenes. What's that doing for the job pool for people like you that are doing it, but, waiting for someone to call?
Sure. Well, like me, like a lot of you in the industry, you got your business card, if a website or whatever, and you wait for a call, and you network, and we're all doing that. And so in the meantime, I got snagged on that job because I had a buddy who was producing, but now there are these companies who just do that. He was working for the company who made the DVD for the movie, and then they had a division that did the behind the scenes. There are companies that just do behind the scenes now that make a deal with the studio, Warner Brothers, Disney, and here's our behind the scene people, and they just go. So it's a little a huge little manufacturing company following these studios. So our jobs are harder and harder to find. That's kind of I'm glad I was in on it at the peak.
All right, so one last question. What is your first name?
Renata. And I was wondering, how do you get a behind-the-scenes shot when the lighting is set for the main stage and the main camera?
If I understand the question, you're how do you get the shot? How do you take the shot? Well, that's a real fortunate thing, because with video, see, I'm not shooting film. With video, it needs a lot of light. And when you're working on the set, unless it's a really dark scene, it's going to be difficult. But most sets are lit, like we're lit right now. So it's going to be lit for you. It's real advantageous to walk in on a set. You're going to see everything. It looks great. Like some of the footage you saw of the interiors, they're lit for camera. You're already lit. It's great.
Well, thanks so much, Tom. Those are wonderful questions. Appreciate the audience for doing that. Thanks, Tom, for that help.
It was really nice being
That's
here.
That's great. Klein.
Well, just, thank you again for being on the show today.
I'll come back.
We'll definitely want you back, and we hope to see more of your work on DVDs worldwide. So thank you again
Pleasure.
For coming on.
Really fun.
Absolutely.
Fun.
And when we come back, we'll be seeing Amy in the Spotlight segment. If you'd like to be a member of our studio audience, to meet and greet film industry professionals, visit our website at ncfc.tv.
Well, Wanda, you, I understand, wrote your first script ever.
Yes.
And I want to find out from you, how did that feel? What was that like?
Well, we've just completed the production of the film, so it's very exciting. But the way I got started is through the Northern California Filmmakers Coalition. Mm-hmm. When I joined that coalition, I took a class at Access Sacramento, and Access Sacramento, the coalition is an umbrella under Access Sacramento. Mm-hmm. So I took a class, and it was a script writing class. It was my first script, and we pitched our scripts in the coalition, and mine won. So it's very exciting.
Oh, that is exciting. That is. So you got a chance to actually see your script come to life.
Yes.
And put to film.
Yes.
How does that make you feel now? Are you excited to write more scripts?
I'm very excited, yes. In fact, I'm starting another script. It's a mystery. And so I'm kind of getting it going right now. I'm getting my juices rolling.
Good. Well, we're going to take a minute and just look at a short clip of your script, Marcus Coffee Habit. Let's take a look at that.
Okay.
So we're getting ready for that big scene.
When we shoot it on this side, right here, we're not getting any of the low points. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, right.
That's what we're gonna do. Over here.
Okay, you're gonna be square. Shoot.
I'm gonna be here.
Here.
And he's just gonna peek in and look at the camera or the coffee cup.
Right.
But
right.
All we see is the back side.
Okay, so we don't want this in there.
No, because he didn't make any. He didn't make it. Now that I blind, you'll get a $25 gift card if you can tell us how many times that coffee sign. That's a joke, right?
Yeah.
But not really. The crowd that we have here.
Right. But not really. Yeah.
So. This is the real one.
Yeah, real. We'll take.
All right.
Okay then. Quiet on the set. Well, actually.
Okay, and action. Man. Come on. You're too far.
Okay.
All right, so from here.
Woo.
That's a tattoo.
What scene is this you're setting up for?
The him putting on his shirt.
Oh.
Wow, well, that was very interesting. We got a chance just now to see some of the behind the scenes of putting that together. And I want to talk a little bit, bring you in, Ilana, in regards to the direction of this particular film short. Mm-hmm. Now, as I understand, you have been a part of some award-winning film shorts and other productions. Mm-hmm. Yeah. How was it to be a part of this particular production?
Oh, this was a lot of fun, actually. I when I first read the script, I was like, oh, this will be cool, you know, guy with a coffee habit. It's kind of, a lot of people go through this kind of situation too, so it'd be kind of fun. I really enjoyed it.
Now, as a director, what were some of the key responsibilities that you had on the film?
Basically, I had to coordinate, see who's going to be the actors. Well, that was kind of a group effort for this particular production.
Okay.
The actors and the crew and everybody came together to do this.
Uh-huh.
As director, I basically directed the actors and made sure everything was running pretty smoothly on time and everything.
How long have you been directing?
This was actually a love of mine from when I was younger, but past couple of years I started my own production company.
Okay, what's the name of the company?
It's Desert Warrior Entertainment.
Desert Warrior Entertainment, right.
And
website?
Kind of Facebook right now.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm trying to still develop a good website right now, but they can look it up on Facebook. I have a page. I have some things on YouTube as well.
So. Okay. So both of you are from, you know, live in the Sacramento area. How did you connect to bring Wanda's vision to life? How did you meet? Was it through the Northern California Film Coalition?
Yes, it's a collaboration. It's the whole, the entire, most of the coalition came together to put this film together. We got the actors, we got actors from the coalition, we got directors, we got camera people. So it was all a part of the coalition, because the whole idea of the Northern California Filmmakers Coalition is to make the coalition the hub of making movies in Sacramento.
Right.
So we're trying to start off, so we're just like the beginning stages of this process, and we're in the midst of making another short film.
So wow. So would you say
exciting.
It is going to be exciting.
Yeah.
And would you say that even though this was your first film, was it pretty smooth in being able to put this together?
I think so. Mm-hmm. Very smoothly. We did a very good job. We worked very well together. Sometimes a little scheduling is a little crazy,
sure.
But we managed to work it all out. And so, and we had fun doing this. It was a
great.
Very exciting. This is my first time being involved in the whole process.
Uh-huh.
And I really got a lot out of that.
Well, thanks so much, you guys. This is wonderful. I wish you the success with Marcus Coffee Habit.
Thank you.
And
thank
we're
you.
Glad to have you on the show. Thanks so much.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Well, that's our show for today. Sacramento Film Works is brought to you by the Northern California Filmmakers Coalition in partnership with Access Sacramento. We'd like to thank our guests and our studio audience. And my name's Clyne Moore.
And I'm Amy Henry. And you've been watching Sacramento Film Works, where we show you
how film works.